Let's have a quick look now at some trends for video. I wish I did have a crystal ball. I'm sure I'd make a lot of money if I could actually really predict trends and the future. But the bottom line is I don't think there's any argument that video is going to become more and more prolific. I think the bottom line is that information and discrete pieces of content for learning these days is all about enabling learning to occur. And that the trend for me in my practice is that it's less about lengthy courses, less about paper, less about content, focusing on the content, less about the trainer being the expert, and more about bite-sized briefings and how-to videos, shorter development times, rich media, multimedia, linked and emergent content that can be quickly made up, and that the focus is on the process, the how-to, peers becoming expert, as the example I tried to describe in Bloomfire. If you do go to Bloomfire, there's a video on the front page that talks you all about what Bloomfire does in 2 minutes. It is all about, I think, mobility, being able to access this content in workflow, in time, in just as I need it, at the point of need. And that some of our roles, for those who are learning development people in this webinar series today, our role becomes as much about enabling people to do this for themselves as anything else. And we become the expert guide in enabling people to capture expertise and disseminate expertise. Is there any questions about or any thoughts about this PowerPoint from the group? It's Bloomfire, Bloomfire. Thank you, Liam, Bloomfire. Another very valuable point, I think, is to make sure that we're making video easy to access. And this is a challenge, particularly in organisations. And from my practice, I think if many organisations just improve their intranet with more bite-sized and useful information, that would go a long way to organisational learning. This is a picture of where I lived up to a month or so ago, where I lived in Glenwood, and the M7 cut right through Glenwood. And on the right-hand side, you can see the start of the bike path, and it goes right up the top. And then the bike path goes all the way across where, just underneath the fence that you can see on the white. So there's this U shape there you can see of the bike path. But as you can see in the next slide, what people really wanted to do was to do a shortcut. So they wanted to actually go through the fence as opposed to having to go the long way away. And this is called desire line. So people will always go for the path of least resistance. And if we find it difficult, if we make it difficult for people to find things, they won't look. They won't go looking for it. They won't use it. So it's very important for us to optimise our time and money that was spent on video to make sure that we use platforms and good tagging and good descriptions to enable people to find it properly. And I wish that I had the opportunity to design a learn how to learn session for new people into organisations so that we can actually teach people how to optimise all the information that we have available to them. Now, Kelly's asking an interesting question saying, on a website, is there such a thing as too much video of business case studies? I don't know the answer to that except to say that there's probably an aesthetics from a website usability and usefulness perspective, and I'm not an expert at that. Sarah, do you have any thoughts?
I think one of the things that we try to focus on with video content, especially on hosting pages, is to really think of the audience. And if you're sending an email or if you're using a website, prioritise it. I think it's the same as social media links. If I go to a website and I see, you know, 10 different ways of sharing an article through 10 different social media pages, I automatically get confused and I don't really do any of it. Whereas if I have, you know, a share with LinkedIn by nature, I'll want to share that. I don't have to look for the best ways to share things. So that's my advice. I think whatever you want to be priority, and I think testing is really important as well, don't you, Alison?
Yes, absolutely.
In terms of testing and trialing and see what works on your website, taking a look at the analytics, seeing what happens on a weekly, monthly and even longer basis to see what works and what doesn't work for your audience.
Yeah, look, thank you very much for that. And I've just put a website on to the chat, and I think I've probably done it incorrectly because it didn't hyperlink, so I probably should have put an HTTP.
I'll do it.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. And if people would like to click on this, there's an example from a company who's using QR codes to enable people to watch videos at the point of need. And in this case, it's actually about patient safety. So examples of QR codes, of videos of how to wash your hands, etc. And what a QR code is, there may be people who don't know what a QR code is. You may have seen it on the newspaper, etc. It's a square box with funny little black and white boxes. And you use a smartphone application to scan that code, and it will open up a website of any sort. And in the case that you can see in this example, it's opening up a video to play in time. So that's an example of making it easy for me to access these videos. For people who might want to generate their own QR code, there are a number of QR code generators which are free. One is called goqr.me, so that's www.goqr.me as an example. Is there any questions from anyone? Thanks very much, Anita. Thanks for sharing that. Qrify is another example of QR code generator. I think just looping now back to using video for teaching and learning, which is the focus of today, it's really important to actually think of video as part of an overall content strategy. So whether you are creating video for a not-for-profit organisation, as part of a training provider strategy, or in your own organisation to enable your employees to get upskilled quicker, thinking about it as part of an overall content strategy will help you think bigger picture about how you're going to enable employees and other people to access content repetitively in the same way time and again, if that makes sense. So the bottom line is what we're trying to do in a content strategy, of which video is so good at, is to reduce some of the confusion of text of content, reduce some of the redundancy, reduce some of the copious amount of content that might typically be in a large document or on screen into something that's sizable, usable, repeatable, shareable. It's back to what Einstein said, I never try to remember what I can look up. And this is exactly where video plays an important role of enabling just-in-time teaching and learning, as well as using it as part of content for an overall training strategy, such as such an overall subject, you know, like a uni subject or unit. Just to give you some takeaways, here's a couple of video links, my blog links from my eLearning Academy blog. One is how I create my videos podcast. That's the example that you saw of me in the bedroom. And how I make my videos using PowerPoint and Camtasia, which I wrote over the weekend so that we had a reference for today. So that's two different types of video made relatively cheaply and, you know, and doesn't need a budget, but does, of course, need time. Now, if anybody has any questions about how they might go about with Camtasia and those blog posts don't answer those, please feel free to give me an email or a phone call. Email preferable if it's going to need a little bit of description, so I can write that description back to you. But if you ask, just looking for have an ad hoc question, more than happy to answer your queries. Someone's asking me about what QR means, and somebody asked me that in the workshop last week, and I didn't know, and I should have looked it up.
It's a quick response.
Oh, QR. Yeah. She's a legend. I'd also just like to, Liam just made a question, asked a question. Oh, it's just disappearing. Sorry about that. I prefer a video over screen capture? So I'm assuming, Liam, what you might mean is the screen capture is in being able to use something like Camtasia to capture a process of a software. And I think that they've got different meanings and different thoughts. So I might say, for example, I want to teach how to use, how to log in a learning management system. I might create a video of what is e-learning in the organisation, that's conceptual video. And then I might then use a screen capture to actually show the end-to-end process using the software itself, if that makes sense.
And just on that QR code, just with Helen, just in regards to what's a QR, it is a quick response. And for a little bit more elaboration, you may have seen either, I think Coca-Cola, their latest promotion was via QR code. And it's almost like a barcode and it's in a square shape. And if you click on that link, you'll be able to see an image of a QR code. So any site that you wish to redirect people to, it's great for trade shows. We use it in trade shows and we want people to maybe access our site via a brochure. We use a QR code and that then connects them straight to the site once they actually use it with their iPhone. My coffee shop even has a QR code for a loyalty card as well, so it can be used for a few different things. And that link will be able to tell you a little bit more about it.
Sensational. Thank you very much for that. And CM has asked, how long does the entire process take to make a 3-minute video? So I'm going to be very honest with you, CM. I've just put a series of 5 videos on eLearning Academy on change management. They range from 5 to 7 minutes, from scripting the 5, videoing them, having little conversations with my partner to try to do that and do it succinctly, editing it through Camtasia, so taking all the bloopers away, putting in the call-outs, putting the audio startup, putting on the homepage, and exporting it to YouTube, which means exporting it to 1280 by 720, then exporting it for a second time in iTunes, which actually means I do have to then edit all the call-outs again to a smaller size. That, for 5 videos, took me 3 days. So it is quite a significant part of my time. But conversely, somebody sent me a series of 12 PowerPoints with a script already being signed off by comms. They actually sent 2 to me. One was 12 screens and one, I think, was 14 screens scripted. So when scripted, it went for 5 minutes and 6 minutes, I think. I put it through Camtasia. I did the audio myself, and that took 3 hours in total for both. So there is a difference between using PowerPoint and using the video and doing a live video shoot, et cetera, if that helps with people.
Mm. And just on the size and the information we spoke about, a few people have been asking, and if you complete the exit survey and put your details down, you'll actually receive a recording of today's webinar, which will also be put on YouTube, by the way, and also a PDF of the slides and any links that we've also mentioned today. So they'll all be in the follow-up email within 48 hours.
That's great. Look, thank you very much, Sarah. And if there's no other questions, thank you very much. And thank you so much to Redback and Sarah for the opportunity to speak to the audience. I really appreciate it. Thank you for staying connected. And very best wishes in your endeavours. And please don't hesitate to give me a call or an email. I'm more than happy to answer your individual questions.
Thanks, everyone. And thanks once again for joining today's webinar. On behalf of Redback, thank you, Alice. Keep a lookout for that email containing the recording. For those of you late, like Cody, busted, and we'll be in contact soon. Thanks, everyone.